there's a ton of noise out there. So how do you get decision makers to pay attention to your brand? Start a podcast and invite your ideal clients to be guests on your show. Learn more at sweetfishmedia.com.
You're listening to B2B Growth, a daily podcast for B2B leaders. We've interviewed names you've probably heard before, like Gary Vaynerchuk and Simon Sinek, but you've probably never heard from the majority of our guests. That's because the bulk of our interviews aren't with professional speakers and authors. Most of our guests are in the trenches leading sales and marketing teams. They're implementing strategy. They're experimenting with tactics. They're building the fastest growing B2B companies in the world. My name is James Carberry. I'm the founder of Sweetfish Media, a podcast agency for B2B brands, and I'm also one of the co-hosts of this show. When we're not interviewing sales and marketing leaders, you'll hear stories from behind the scenes of our own business. We'll share the ups and downs of our journey as we attempt to take over the world. Just kidding. Well, maybe. Let's get into the show. Welcome back to B2B Growth. I'm your host for today's episode, Logan Lyles with Sweetfish Media. Today is another episode in our Why Podcast Work series, where we're talking to Sweetfish customers and other podcasters about the benefits that they've seen from their podcast for their brand. Today, I'm joined by Ronny Sage. He is the founder and CEO over at ShoppingGives, and also he is the host of the Impact Exchange podcast. Ronny, how's it going today, man?
Thanks so much for having me. Appreciate it, Logan. Very good.
Absolutely, man. Well, that is good to hear. You and I connected a little while ago, actually through a mutual connection, Todd Capone. He mentioned you guys have been seeing some great results with your podcast. So I appreciate you taking some time to chat with me online here, share with listeners a little bit about your experience. For folks who don't know you already, give us a little bit of background on yourself and what you and the team at ShoppingGives are up to, man.
Yeah. So I'm a native digital marketer. I had a background in e-commerce and at agency working with brands and retailers. And, out of this conversation with brands and retailers, there is always a common question of how do we create more relevant experiences, acquire more customers for cheaper, faster, that have a longer lifetime value. And I saw how much was being spent to acquire customers, you know, the $24 billion annually that gets spent in the last few years digitally just acquire customers. And I said, there had to be a better way to spend that money that's more authentic and creating more meaningful relationships with customers. So we launched ShoppingGives 2 years ago, 2017. And we started with a marketplace approach that was enabling customers to shop through our marketplace and give back to the to the nonprofit of the customer's choice by stopping at ShoppingGives before they checked out. And we've since evolved to a SaaS-based solution or software as a service-based solution for retailers in which we provide them a technology that lives in their shopping cart and becomes a native experience for the retailer and the consumer. And that enables really a frictionless experience between the two parties and that creates a more authentic relationship between the customer and that retailer based on enabling the retailer to give back to the nonprofit that the customer chooses directly from their checkout.
I love it, man. As you were talking about that evolution in your business model, that really made sense to me. And you hit the nail on the head there with frictionless, making it easier for both the buyer and the brand to be able to achieve the end goal that they're looking for there. So knowing a little bit about the background there at ShoppingGives, who you guys serve, tell us a little bit about your path to podcasting. What did you see the role of your podcast, the Impact Exchange, playing in for both the community that you guys serve as well as, you know, for your company and your brand at the same time?
Yeah, that's a great question, Logan. You know, in the conversations throughout our lifetime of ShoppingGives and talking to retail executives, whether that be a chief marketing officer, VP of e-commerce, anybody in those two realms, you know, above and below, it always lends itself to how are we being either authentic and portraying what we're doing that's positive to our consumers that is meaningful and will resonate. And that a lot of times these retailers approach impact or what we call impact, which is giving back or corporate social responsibility. We summarize that with the term impact. So if I say that, that's what it means. But you know, the challenge being that they a lot of times support different nonprofits and that might not resonate. That's who the leadership believes, you know, is a match or who they support. And that's not necessarily who the customer supports. So it's a guessing game. And that's the same, whether that be for legacy brands or these digitally native brands or Instagram brands that you see pop up overnight. You know, there are the similar challenges in that regard of who to support and how to support them and be authentic in that giving. That lends itself to the team. And that in this day and age where millennials are the largest growing workforce, that it's more about values and ethics and what the company stands for and how you communicate that in your hiring, in your actual, the daily lives of the employee, and how to get them involved in corporate social responsibility. And the last area really is around the product, and that the value of sustainability, the value of sourcing, and the value of manufacturing, and where products are made and how they're made, and the impact on the environment, and all that good stuff that goes into it. So when I look at this as a 360 approach to impact, that was the conversations we're having and what we're hearing feedback from. Looking at that type of conversation on a one-on-one basis, I saw that there was obviously common threads between, there were obvious common threads between these conversations. So in discussion with my COO, Phil Caulfield, we said, there has to be a way to communicate all this. Do we start with a publication? Do we need to start writing more about this. We're hearing this type of feedback. So we initially started this, and it was, again, an evolution. We said, let's create a medium where we could be an agnostic source of information, where it's a passive source of information, where we could take a thought leadership perspective and share what we're learning from, you know, the marketplace and give it back to them. And then it quickly evolved to, let's create a podcast. You know, funny enough, both Phil and I, my business partner, one of my business partners, have recording backgrounds, right? So music business backgrounds, completely could go into a separate conversation another day about our path to where we got to. But we enjoy the technicalities of recording and engineering sound. And so Phil, more than me, he is producing it and editing the podcast. But he was like, yeah, that sounds like a fun idea. Go and get the retailers. So
yeah,
we started it with an idea that it was going to be both nonprofits and retailers in those conversations. It's naturally progressed, I think, to more of a retailer conversation. So the podcast is called The Impact Exchange. And The Impact Exchange focuses on the crossroad or where impact or corporate social responsibility and retail to come together. And we discuss that intersection of corporate social responsibility and how that plays a role in the ecosystem of retail and brands and their life cycle and all those other things that we just talked about of how to approach team, product, and customer authentically.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And the thing that you touched on there, Ronny, I love the background there. Love what you guys are doing, talking about, you know, how important impact is to millennials in their buying decisions, those sorts of things. I personally like that because one, I think a lot of people think millennials are 18-year-olds and whoops, you missed the generation. They're 32-year-olds, you know, like myself, coming up in the ranks in organizations. And we're not all just lazy, entitled millennials like some of those labels. So just had to camp on that for a second as a millennial talking to you. But then two, you talked about this 360 view of the conversation. And I think that's a great analogy too in the benefits you guys have seen from the podcast. Because as you and I were talking a little bit offline, you mentioned, you know, these three areas that you guys have really seen a benefit, and it's almost like they form this circle. You know, you're building community with the listener base, but then you're also developing relationships with the guests, which gives you more content to feed back to that engaged community. So let's kind of talk about each one of those in turn. What have you guys seen from the community building aspect as you guys have, you know, released the episodes, turned that into more, published to Medium, and just put these thought leadership pieces out there into the community that you're trying to serve?
That's, again, another great question. You know, the ability to do thought leadership has organically lended itself to create meaningful conversations between myself and my team and these retailers, because we are truly trying to create an authentic platform for conversation and to share their goals and to approach a conversation with a retailer and say, we want to evangelize what you're looking to do as a organization in impact. So how can we help you evangelize those goals and talk through your challenges? Because those challenges are very similar to what other people are having similar challenges to from, you know, anywhere in the space. So how can we tell your story in a meaningful way? So those conversations lend themselves to be much more transparent and much more approachable when we reach out and say, hey, we want you to be a thought leader on our show. And here's why, and let's discover together what the story could be. And if you're not ready for this conversation, completely okay. But if you are, let's figure out a way to really maximize the reach on this. So even though we're a growing publication and hundreds of listeners, not thousands yet, but you know, quickly ramping up, and we see that grow each and every episode, it becomes an ability and new content for the retailer to share and organically share their story, right? Sometimes that's unauthentic if they just say, here's all the good we're doing. But if they are asked the questions of the good that they're doing and another source is sharing that, it becomes much more authentic and passive. So we become that outlet for them to tell their stories organically. And they are able to share that content and have a new type of content to share, which is a huge value to them. And then we have a type of content to share that is not self-promoting and self-clouding, right? We are able to say, here is meaningful thought leadership. And we could also reference back other stats, right? So that enables me to say, I just quoted a stat from Edelman that 87% of customers are more likely to support a brand who gives back to a cause that they care about. And now I'm going to tag Edelman in that I just quoted them. And hopefully that increases my overall listening potential and drives value to both the retailer and myself and to the consumer because it drives more attention to the content.
Yeah, absolutely. I love what you're talking about there, you know, to this first point of community building. And what I hear you saying is, you know, you've got to take a second, pause, and up-level the conversation a little bit because then it has benefits for the people you're trying to engage with. It has benefits for your brand as opposed to, hey, we want to talk to you and this is what we want to talk about. These are the problems we solve. Let's just go right at it. You take a step back and look at the higher level conversation. Take a moment to engage those decision makers, those people that you want to engage with in the meaningful conversation at a higher level. And it ends up creating this thought leadership effect for your brand and allows them, like you said, gives them assets, gives them content assets to be able to share in the good that they're doing. So there's value to them, but it's not just coming from their brand, right? It's third-party validation because you've now featured them on your show. They're not just beating their chest. So it delivers value to them. Speak a little bit to the next step there, Ronnie, in the relationships you guys have been able to foster by slowing it down, having these higher level conversations with people strategic for you guys in the market that you're serving. How has that played out for both you guys and for the folks that you've had on as guests of the show?
What has happened? What kind of impact has been created for us personally from this? And I think if I take a step back and say, where has this progressed to and what kind of opportunities are, I'm not necessarily yet correlating bottom line to thought leadership. And I don't think that's a fair way of approaching it. Or would I want to have a mindset going into a conversation of, hey, I'm going to do this podcast with you. Now let's close business together and, you know, let's have a sales conversation. That's not at all the intent. And I think that that's the wrong way of going about this. And if you have those expectations, you're going to fail in the approach to developing content. You know, my goal personally is to develop relationships with these thought leaders and incorporate them in my network. And I think that, you know, I'm a big proponent of people joke around with me for not having friends, but having best friends. And that after I meet somebody, you're not my best friend. And if you ask if I know them, I'm going to say you're my best friend. So Logan, you're my best friend now. When somebody asks for a reference about you, but you know, I think it's an opportunity to create passive recommendations and passive referrals. And that if I am top of mind in that conversation, because if it naturally progresses to, hey, thanks so much for having me, tell me more about what you do and how this was started, which is always a question, I'm able to share with them why we started the Impact Exchange and what we do. And when the time is right, I've become a trusted source for them, I hope, to, you know, be in consideration for helping them to, you know, evolve and develop their corporate social responsibility strategy. And if it's not the right time, then at least I'm top of mind for their, you know, retailers know retailers and the network knows the network within this. And it's a very big, small world in, you know, an incestuous world in this retail environment where people are hopping around. So if it's not right now, hopefully they talk about us and share with us and their network's going to see that with us and that there becomes some potential passive opportunities for us. So That's really where we've seen it, is that there's other people reach out and ask for opportunities, or I've built relationships with some of these brands, teams, really, really meaningful friendships out of this, that they might not be ready right now, but I hope that when they are ready to, you know, and if they see an opportunity to create impact on every purchase, you know, they would go to us to be that solution for them. So long-winded. Yeah. That's where we've seen.
No, man, that's great. It is, you know, it's not always a direct, oh, hey, you know, a podcast allows me to interview people in my target market and boom, they sign up. to be a customer. But like you said, when you approach it by delivering value to them and realizing that, hey, I'm starting off this relationship with a win-win for you and for me, it just changes the game. You make friends with your podcast guests, right? Yeah. I love that I'm counted as one of your best friends. And I've had so many people on this podcast that I now have friendships with. And I feel like, hey, I can text and ask them a marketing question or something along those lines. And sure. Some of the guests that we've had on our show have turned into clients, but oftentimes, you know, they are in the market that we serve. We serve B2B marketers like you serve retail brands, and they know the right people and they have a positive affinity to our brand because we've highlighted them, we've had engaging conversations. And the thing that you pointed out is you've built trust because you're doing it genuinely with these conversations, and they end up referring you to the right people because you are top of mind, not just for the service that you deliver, but for your thought leadership in the space. I mean, I don't think I could have said it better than you did. My recap's probably too long-winded.
Yeah. No, I think that you're on point there. And I think something else to note is, you know, we aspire and who we reach out to for the podcast is some people that we can't even service, right? Like really large companies that are not in what we call, you know, our named account, right? So we, of course, I put on my BDR hat every day from 10 a.m. to 2 p.m. with my co-founder, and we are BDRs and we are doing outreach and sales and all the fun stuff that a BDR does because we're lean and small and still a growing startup. So we wear many hats. So during that time frame, you know, when we're playing that BDR role, we're calling a company that's very specific in who's our customer. And that looks like a retailer who's anywhere from 10 to 250 million and has an e-commerce experience and is either not sure we're going to start an impact or is already doing it, but doesn't have a way to incorporate and engage the customer. So that's how we qualify and that's where we look. If there's ones that come above that 250 million in annual e-commerce revenue, we'll absolutely have those conversations and be, as I'm sure you've heard from Todd Capone, very transparent in the approach of here's what we can do and here's how we can service you. Love you, Todd, best friend. You know, we'll be transparent with that. But if I could get those retailers who are $1 billion, $2 billion, $5 billion to be on the podcast, those are the thought leaders and who these digitally native brands look up to. I would love to have Eric Nordstrom on our show. And he's an incredible, transparent thought leader. And I, you know, if I could get him on the show, other listeners are going to listen to him and other who are the retailers and look to him for advice. And I, even if I am not calling on Nordstrom right now, absolutely they're a target for me long-term, but like that is not who I'm calling on a daily basis, let's say.
Yeah, absolutely. So we've talked about, you know, the community building as you put out this thought leadership content for the community that you want to engage, the relationships, the referrals, the best friends that you make in your target market by having these folks on, whether they, you know, fit your profile to buy from you or they're more of a thought leader in the space and are outside of your ICP, you know, there's benefits to all of that. And then, you know, the third piece that kind of brings it back full circle, as we talked about, to the community building. And as you talked about, you and your business partner putting on your BDR hats and doing outreach, you now have relevant content from people in the target market that you serve that you can serve up to these people that you're trying to directly reach out to, right? It comes back around full circle.
Yep. And I think that that's, you know, the best way to engage and sell is to add value, right? And not push product, but push resources. And that is, again, if you read Transparency Sale, part of that is leading with value. And this is organic value, right? Owned value versus sharing unorganic content or syndicated content, let's say. So I think that this lends itself to be of higher caliber, of higher value, and being able to really establish yourself as the thought leader in the conversation of not here's something I found that you might find interesting, which is the number one secondary intro email to to these BDR, you know, the emails that I get in of, hey, I thought you might find this interesting. It changes the conversation to, I just had this conversation and interviewed this person. We did this podcast and here's what she talked about or he talked about. And here are some highlights. This is why I'm sharing it with you because this is relevant to your brand based on what she said.
Yep, absolutely. We talked a lot about earlier in the conversation, Ronny, about the trust that you build with your community and with the people that you interview and their teams as you make friends there. And the second part here that I know, you know, sales and marketing leaders and founders are trying to build with their market is trust, as we talked about here, but also credibility. And when you're creating this content, even if you're not the one, you know, sharing these stats and you're not the featured guest, you're not the highlight one on your episode, it's actually better because it's tied to you directly, but you're not the one just shouting these things from the rooftops. You have that borrowed brand affinity, if you will, with the folks that you're interviewing on your show. And that content is resonating with the people that you're reaching out to, right?
Absolutely. And by no means am I good at it yet, right? Like it's not, you know, it's absolutely takes time to become a good interviewer and to think about what you have to say and how you want to respond, but continue to listen and to have an engaging conversation that is taking them down a path that you believe is going to be the most, resonate the most with your audience. And that's not easy to do and to do politely, let's say. You know, if you find something that's not interesting or something that's not what you think would be resonating, to be able to say, let's take the story somewhere else.
Right.
And to be able to have that transparent and honest conversation of, you know what, I think that we should really go here with the conversation can become a challenge. And I think that it's something that I'm continuing to learn and it's bettering me in other aspects of business to be able to say, all right, Ronny, shut up. You need to just listen more and not think about how to respond because that you have to practice that in the conversation.
Yep, absolutely. I think that being a podcast host has improved my sales skills as I've, you know, thought more analytically about how I navigate conversations, the questions that I ask, all of those sorts of things. You know, we've had John Ruggi on this series of Why Podcasts Work, and he was talking about how it also has benefited him in the conversations by being able to hone and improve his messaging because he's hearing people from his target market speak about things and the lingo they use and what are the common things. So I think you're exactly right that improvement as a podcast host and as someone who's trying to serve the market in which you're interviewing people on your podcast, you're improved as either a marketer, a salesperson, a founder who's wearing a lot of different hats like yourself. If you had one piece of advice for a marketer or a founder or anyone else who's looking to start a podcast for their B2B brand, Ronny, what would you offer up to them?
I would say you need to really find your niche. You know, it's not about creating general content for everybody. It's really about finding the story that is not always about what you want to say and not about your brand directly. It should be non-tangential, I guess would be the word, to your brand, right? If it's in a parallel path and not directly in the same lane, it's okay. As long as it fits a conversation that is appealing to your audience. Mm-hmm. And if you could become a thought leader to your audience about a content that is related to what you're doing, that's great. A lot of businesses out there that creating a podcast about would not be enjoyable to, I'm sure, even their own listeners, right? And to themselves, right? They're selling things. Imagine a payday loan company, which I obviously don't agree with payday loans in general, but imagine a payday loan company trying to create a podcast. That would be a horrible experience for everybody.
Right.
So what kind of content you pop out of that?
Right.
But,
right.
You know, horrible example there, but like, how do you create a conversation that's relevant, that's niche enough, and that's not, that's going to be relatable and approachable?
Yeah, I love that. That really echoes what I'm talking to a lot of future customers about who are thinking about a podcast for their brand is, you know, don't make it all about your product and service.
Right.
Level up the conversation like you talked about earlier and make it about the category, the industry that you serve. You know, we have this series here on B2B Growth, Why Podcasts Work. But if our podcast was solely all the time, 100% about podcasting, it wouldn't be that interesting to your analogy of payday loans, but we're talking about all other things that B2B marketers and sales professionals care about that is parallel or, you know, where podcasting kind of fits into.
Right.
And so the example and the way that you laid it out there, I think is exactly true. And
rings true. Nice. It was a really horrible example, but that is correct. But, you know, we service a very specific niche in impact, which is SaaS technology that lives in the shopping cart that enables your customer to donate to their cause of choice. That is impact on purchase. And that is donations on purchase. That is a section of corporate social responsibility that is really, really specific. But mm-hmm. our conversation is much more broad in the corporate social responsibility space, right? We don't really do sustainability. We are, you know, we try to be sustainable. We're, you know, really striving to become a B Corp here. And we're doing a lot of great things to push and make sure that we're aligned with what we're preaching. And that's okay that you are very specific, just like you are. You're a podcast and you do podcast service and you are producer of that content and you help evangelize and create meaningful stories, but you're having a broader conversation. So that's dead on with what you said.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. You've got to niche down and then play bigger, as Christopher Lockhead would say. So I think you hit the nail on the head. So many people try to go an inch deep and a mile wide and become the next Gary Vee with their content, which, you know, as much as we love some of his content, you're just not going to flip on the mic and become Gary Vee. Wouldn't you rather go a mile deep, go and resonate and make best friends with your target market, your ICP? And so many people don't have the idea deal down in their ICP, and that's a whole other conversation. But anyway, I love this advice for folks as you're talking about, make it not about your product or service. Let's talk about bigger issues, but let's niche down into the area that you focus. With those three, I think you've got a really good recipe for success if you dive into a podcast for your brand. So Ronny, I love the advice. I love the story. I wish you guys nothing but the best. I would love for you to share with listeners how they can stay connected with you so you can make some more best friends, how they can learn more about ShoppingGives and where they can find the Impact Exchange podcast, man.
Sure. So you could follow ShoppingGives, go to shoppinggives.com. You could follow us on Twitter, Instagram, Facebook, of course. To follow me, follow at RD Sage on Twitter. And to learn more about the Impact Exchange, go to Medium and / the Impact Exchange, or just search the Impact Exchange on Medium and follow our publication on there and learn about all our great podcasts and other thought leadership content that we push out.
Awesome, man. This has been an absolute pleasure. Thank you so much for sharing a little bit about your journey so far. We'll have to have you on again as your podcast continues to grow. Appreciate it, Ronny.
Thank you so much. Appreciate it, Logan. Bye now.
We totally get it. We publish a ton of content on this podcast, and it can be a lot to keep up with. That's why we've started the B2B Growth Big Three, a no-fluff email that boils down our three biggest takeaways from an entire week of episodes. Sign up today at sweetfishmedia.com/big3. That's sweetfishmedia.com/big3.